What's up, everybody? Happy Wednesday. It's time for our Wednesday edition of the High Five. And well, let's start off with our NFL top five. We do this every Wednesday. Not a lot of change at the top. The Kansas City Chiefs still the number one team in my power rankings. Hey, the Dolphins are not an easy matchup, especially on the road. That's a really good defense. And I know it ended up as a one possession game, but despite a slow start, the Chiefs really ended up kind of controlling things. Packers are number two. Again, still not totally sold. They're the best team of the NFC, but they are right now. And right now they have the top seed in the NFC after the Saints lost to the Eagles in one of those. Well, it's the NFL type of games. I don't think it's really an indictment against the Saints a whole lot. I just think they kind of ran into a team that had a nice little combination of things going on, and the Saints just couldn't quite get the job done. Number three for me, the Buffalo Bills. The way they beat and controlled the Steelers is no joke. This is a team that's starting to get back to their 2019 defense. Their defense at the beginning of the year was a little unimpressive, but man, that offense is really dynamic with Beasley and Diggs and Dawson Knox, and then a nice little running back platoon with Singletary and Moss, and Josh Allen is playing at a near MVP level. All right, number four for me, I'm going to go with the Saints. I think that Drew Brees makes them better. I still, as I've said in the past, not sure if Drew Brees has enough left in the tank to give him a Super Bowl run, but that defense is really good. It was not their night or their afternoon against the Eagles. I'm going to give them that fourth spot for one more week, but that is definitely a little shakier than some of these other rankings. And number five for me, not the Pittsburgh Steelers, no. There's something that looks off with the Steelers. I'm going to go with the Los Angeles Rams. Jared Goff seems to be figuring things out. They are incredibly versatile and dynamic offensively, and that is a really, really tough defense. I'm going with the Rams number five. And honestly, it was really tough for me not to put them over the New Orleans Saints. I think this Chris Carson reemergence and health in Seattle has made Seattle much tougher and more formidable of opponent. Still, the offensive line and defense present some questions, but they're knocking on the door. Obviously, Pittsburgh is in the conversation. So is Tampa Bay. But I go with the Rams to round that out. All right, number two. I'm happy about Giannis. I didn't really think the Mavs had a super chance to get him. And frankly, the reality is this. Just because Giannis signed the Supermax doesn't mean he can't be a Maverick in 2 years. You know, look at what James Harden's doing. If, you know, an NBA player is unhappy and they want to move, then they can force a trade. You know, they can force their way out of town. Really the Supermax was almost, in my mind, a fait accompli, because, you know, players just don't leave $60 million or whatever it is on the table by passing on the Supermax and, electing free agency. But this is good. This is good for the NBA, and it's tough not to root for Giannis. Milwaukee is not one of these organizations that benefits from the NBA CBA. Those organizations are big market organizations. Milwaukee is not one of those. They need to draft, and they need to build a team around someone, a star that fell into their laps. And they deserve credit for obviously drafting or acquiring Giannis, but make no mistake, it's not going to be easy for them to sign a guy like Giannis. So to keep him is huge. He didn't draw it out. There wasn't this big soap operas, dramatic episode of will he stay or will he go. Good for the Bucks, good for Giannis, and good for NBA. It's nice to see some diversity in that regard with the teams that are going to be at the top. And as long as Giannis is in Milwaukee, they're going to be a contending team. There's still plenty out there for the Mavericks. Number three, this takes me to the Mavericks. Really cool gesture by Mark Cuban, Donnie Nelson, Rick Carlisle, and the Mavericks signing J.J. Barea, knowing that they were going to release him so that he could play this year or spend this year with a guaranteed salary. You know, who knows if J.J. Barea will get signed by an NBA team or when it will be. It might not be until the middle of the season when a guard gets hurt and a veteran guard is needed and he gets brought in. But it's a really cool gesture. Bill Belichick has had a ton of success. You know, a lot of people think he's the greatest coach in the NFL, maybe the greatest coach in sports, depending on who you ask. He has gone about it in a very cutthroat, no nonsense, very little relationship or emotion type of way. And that's worked for him. And when something works for someone, we think that, well, it must be a great way to do it. It's worked for Bill Belichick. Now, he's had Tom Brady, and so it's worked while also having arguably the greatest quarterback in NFL history. But I tend to think that in sports, especially these days, that style, that cutthroat style, the no relationships, no emotion style, well, that's a low odd proposition to have sustainable success. You've got to connect. You've got to have relationships. All right. You've got to be able to show that emotion and show that you care. I just think it matters too much. And Mark Cuban doing what he did with JJ Barea isn't guaranteeing the Mavs a title, but players notice that. Players take note. They are aware. Those things matter. Those things make a difference. And I just think that if you were to have 10 coaches, 10 organizations run like the Patriots, 10 coaches, owners, whatever organizations run like the Mavericks, I know obviously different sports, different rules and whatnot, but I think that the organizations that are run more closely like the Mavericks will end up having more success over the long run than the organizations run like how Bill Belichick runs the Patriots. Now, again, last thing, I understand that there hasn't been a more successful organization in sports maybe in my lifetime than the Patriots, but I'm also saying that I think it's tough to separate the way Bill Belichick has run his program from the fact that he also had the best quarterback of all time, perhaps, to help him through a lot of that. Bill Belichick is an outstanding coach. Don't get me wrong. I just think that the way that Mark Cuban runs things, and a lot of owners and coaches and people in leadership positions who act similarly to Mark Cuban, that stuff resonates. And that was a cool gesture there from Cubes. All right, number four, we're going to end with the Rangers. Just a quick note, USC. Everyone knows, a lot of people know that I went to USC. I love USC. I am so passionate about USC sports. USC football frustrates me to no end, but I still love them so, so much. I wish they would make a coaching change. I wish that their athletic department had a clue, and maybe Mike Bone, their new AD as of last year, has a clue. We'll wait and see. But when the college football playoff rankings came out yesterday, I went to see where my beloved 5-0 Trojans were, and they were 13th behind Coastal Carolina, behind two-loss Oklahoma, behind two-loss Iowa State, Florida, Georgia. What the heck? And then I thought about it and I realized I don't know that I can make an argument that they're really better than these teams. They're 5-0 because they've beat five teams. And that's the Pac-12. The Pac-12 is such a joke when it comes to football. And the Pac-12 in general, from a leadership standpoint, Larry Scott, their commissioner, you got to go. You are such a joke. You see what you're doing to this conference? A brand name, a blue blood program, USC. We're not talking about Oregon State. We're talking about USC. They are a flagship program. They're 5-0, and they're 13th because the teams they beat all suck. There's not a single other Pac-12 team in the top 20. Colorado barely in there in the top 25 at 25. What are you doing to this conference? I want to be upset that USC is 13th. I can't be upset because I can't justify that they are for sure better than these two lost teams ahead of them, including a non-blue blood program like Iowa State or Coastal Carolina, who, yes, they're 11-0, and yes, they beat BYU, but name any other year where an undefeated USC is ranked behind an undefeated Coastal Carolina. But Coastal Carolina is probably better than them. Who knows? USC has played no one. I want to be upset that they're ranked 13th. I can't be. I also have zero issue with the top four. Alabama, Notre Dame, Clemson, Ohio State, to me, are the four best teams. Ohio State is fourth, and they are the most tenuous of that group. But even though they just played five games, their defense looked a little off towards the end of their run, I still think they're the best team in that conference. I still think they're one of the four best teams in the country. I think they're better than A&M. Maybe Florida's better than them, but two-loss Florida ain't getting in over 5-0 Ohio State because, hey, the Big Ten actually has a clue. All right, finally, David Dahl. I'm really happy about that signing. I know for some of you it might be tough to get super fired up because of where the Rangers are organizationally, but this puts them in a position where they can do things like this. David Dahl had a horrible year last year, but a lot of it probably was because of the shoulder injury he played through that required surgery towards the end of the year. Also, small sample size, weird year, easy to throw that out. Take that away. He's got a 111 career OPS. That means his offensive production has been 11% better than league average based on that metric. He also plays the field really well. He can play center for the Rangers. He'll likely play left. He can run the bases. This is a young hitter, a young player who, for whatever reason, Colorado decided to part ways with. A lot of people were really shocked by that. The Rangers got him for less than $3 million base salary. He can get up to three with incentives. Plus, they got him under control for the next few years because he has not reached his free agency service time yet. So this is a really good signing. Let's say David Dahl doesn't work out. Let's say last year wasn't because of the shoulder injury and just the wacky set of circumstances. All right, no big deal. You've spent less than $3 million on that guy. But there's a really good chance that David Dahl could be around for quite some time. This is a very, very intriguing, low-risk, high-reward type of move. And the risk is really low because this is a guy who's an all-star in 2019. I really like this move. Side note, the Rangers traded Rafael Montero yesterday. Hey, anyone with value who might not be a part of the next wave of Rangers teams is very likely to be traded or certainly to have a lot of discussions about that individual. Relievers are at the top of that list. Not a big surprise. Rafael Montero got moved. The Rangers got 17-year-old prospect Jose Corniel, who's among the top 30 in a very good Seattle farm system. One reason why he was in the 20s, he's 17. 17-year-old prospects don't even typically get that sort of ranking consideration. We'll see if he continues to develop, but this is what you have to do when you're in the Rangers position. You add and you add and you add prospects. You don't just say, screw the quality. We want anyone we can get. It's open sign up. No, you've got to see quality as well. But the more tickets you can get, the more likely a few of them turn out to be really, really successful. So I like the direction of where things are going. That's our Wednesday high five. Hope you have a great hump day. We'll talk to you on Friday.